No idea. I haven't seen him in a while.
Changing puppy nappies.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Pues no son de aquí, yo sé. Hoy son de los locales, ya sabes. Yeah, I think the worst thing with you, because they were calling them the 46 police force, were calling the British.
Oh, yeah,
I'm going with
that.
Yeah. They were talking about Troy Collett and somebody else, and they were calling them the British duo. Yeah. Absolutely, yeah.
But did you see the people that were arrested?
I know. For the fucking trucks.
The island of Ireland.
Yeah, yeah.
6 hours earlier, Northern Ireland was British and had to live with regular.
And I was reading the comments, and they were insulting hate, like, they were insulting hate from, you know, English and Irish. You know, how dare them Irish come over and do this to England? Yes,
I what you now maybe for the next 5 minutes go a little bit through just again the evaluation designs we discussed in depth actually on Friday. Maybe she arrives then and I can talk I think now about the slides. I just had to look at them in more detail and just give you an overview of what the government does, okay? So we hope she still arrives, okay? So because I think the presentation is one thing, but it's actually the discussion with her, I think, that would really benefit you, because she's very good in, you know, giving you real insights into how IHS works. We have any, just to recap, okay? So, and that's also, I still think she's probably just stuck in traffic or so. If you were in thinking about evaluation, so you have really three key methods, okay? So it's a process evaluation, where you try to look at how to improve the implementation of a policy. And then you have an impact evaluation, where you look at, is the policy actually achieving the outcomes? And think of the grid we used on Friday. It's, you have to consider the two goals, and I think there was a confusion on Friday. So what's the aim of the evaluation? Okay, so the aim of the evaluation can be either looking at the process, looking at the outcomes, looking at efficiency, and what's the aim of the policy? And for the impact evaluation, the aim of the impact evaluation is to look at the outcomes. Is it achieving certain outcomes? And then you look at the policy. So what kind of goals are associated with the policy? And we looked at the working family payment, where the main policy goal was to reduce poverty for families. So you would evaluate that goal. That's the main indicator you look at. You ignore all many other effects of families in the first place. So with the introduction of the working family payment, did poverty go down or not? Okay, so that's an issue we're looking at. So here she is. So, so just as a repeat, okay? So think about that, and then think about economic evaluation as well. So with that primer, we'll probably give Jasmina a few seconds just to arrive. Probably was traffic, guys, it's you.
Yeah,
yeah, so was traffic rather. So now think of that. What can now, and think of all the political dimension of evaluations we've discussed in the first lecture, also about the ethics. These are all good questions to keep in mind. Once Jasmina's ready. Are you ready?
I'm ready, yeah.
Okay.
Apologies.
So Jasmina is head of IGES, which is the Irish Government Evaluation Service. And I think it's not really new.
Yeah,
or it's yours, if you're ready. But take your time.
Again.
Thanks for coming, honestly.
Thanks for any opportunities to talk to students. So as Stefan said, I'm an economist.
Employment Economic and Evaluation Service, and I'm based in the Department of Public Standards and Reform. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about the service and the work that we do, I suppose with the objective to give you a sense of what we do, and you know, for us, if we, you know, you are the next generation of people who will hopefully come and work for the Irish government and help design policies across a number of areas. So to give you the flavour, and then for us to suppose raise awareness of the work that we do, and to give you a sense of what it means in the real world, you know, the stuff that you learn in terms of techniques and concepts, what does it actually mean when you apply it. So I'm sure you've covered this in a number of your courses, but it's just to kind of say that, you know, the government basically interferes in the market, in markets because of a number of reasons. So the markets fail, and that can, you know, happen in relation to different things. So it can be about externalities, positive, negative. It can be about the issue of public primary goods. Concentrated market power, and so there's all these different reasons that markets don't always bring the best outcome, and that the state then interferes. So, and the way the state interferes can be through numerous sort of instruments. So it can be regulation, so you just set the rules of the game to prevent some of these things happening. You can then spend money, so you can have the expenditure to try to correct certain things. So you spend money on, say, providing social housing, providing welfare, if the markets don't appear, you know, that there's still an inefficient outcome for people because we have homelessness and we have unemployment and so on. So the state interferes through expenditure on different schemes, giving grants, say, to enterprises and so on, and through taxation. So there's different instruments through which we can actually intervene. So I'm going to focus on the expenditure side, okay? And think about, you know, the budget that the government has, and how that budget then is divided between different priorities and often, you know, competing priorities. And this slide just shows you what's happened this year. Okay, so this year we have 76 billion, of which you can kind of write off about 10 billion, which goes towards some legal obligations, EU payments, debt servicing, and, you know, stuff that we have to do. And then what's left is 66 billion, which is then spent across these areas. And you can see the largest spending areas are social protection, so welfare and pensions, and then healthcare provision and education. So these are the lines, and then the rest is spent between, you know, agriculture and transport and enterprise and so on. So that's just to give you a sense of how the budget is leading up. So in terms of that intervention and spending. And, you know, the question is how do we ensure that limited amount of money? So we don't have an infinite amount of money to do all the stuff that we would like to do. We have an infinite, we have a finite sum of money, 66 billion this year. And how do we then prioritise that spend? You know, like how do we make decisions around what to fund and what not to fund? And this is how the policy space and the discussion around how that money should be divided kind of looks like. So there are all these voices and all these causes, you know, which one would like to be able to do something about. So you have Brexit, you have homelessness, you have healthcare in the EQs, you have pensions and the aging demographic, you have the environment and the climate change. So there's so many things that, you know, are worthwhile causes, but, you know, how do you then divvy up the money between all of this? And this particularly becomes acute at the time of the budget when, you know, okay, so you have all these things that you're already funding. You know, if you're paying welfare payments, unemployment benefits to be unemployed people, you're funding hospitals, you're funding schools, so there's a lot of expenditure there. already, but then there is usually, is any additional money, how do we divvy that? And this is where Irish Government Economic and Evaluation Service comes in. So really, we were established in the aftermath of the financial crisis of the recession that happened in the bursting of the housing bubble in 2008. And at the time when it kind of became, you know, very obvious that we didn't have the means to fund a lot of these things, and the questions were raised, are we confident that the way we allocate money is actually delivering the best value for money for the citizen, and that we're delivering services in the best and most efficient and effective way that we can. And at that point, it became obvious that the capacity across the government departments was not, in most cases, where it really should be to be able to actually make decisions around proper prioritization around the expenditure. And but a lot of decisions were made, you know, based on obviously, you know, as it should be, around political inputs and, you know, social, economic inputs. But there was not that much work done on, you know, this what we do work. Deliver on what we set out to do. Are we doing it in the most efficient way? Should we stop certain things? So the capacity to actually reflect on that in a technical way wasn't well developed. And that's why IGES was established in 2012, to build that capacity. Okay, so we started building that. And this is to say that, you know, it wasn't only when IGES was introduced that some of this kind of thinking was in place. There were people in government departments who were doing this, but it just didn't seem that it was embedded as a kind of a major contributor to the policy formulation and implementation. So what we tried to do is to identify those pockets of activity on economic analysis and evaluation, and we then went on to build it through specialist recruitment. So we run recruitment every year. We've been doing that since 2012. Of policy analysts and placing them into government departments, and now we have presence in all government departments of 17. So we recruit people, and we've been recruiting continuously since 2012 with annual recruitment campaigns, adding 130. Now this year is intake is going to be closer to 150 policy analysts to add to any capacity that was already there. And then when we get people in, we provide an extensive sort of learning and development program as well to nurture that capacity and be able to take from inside as well. We also introduced an internship program. We piloted it last year, and then we rolled it out this year, which is a very successful program for us. And really as a kind of a pipeline of that kind of new generation of policy analysts. So it's not just about getting the right people in who can do policy analysis, it's also about what they do. So our people around these 17 departments have produced over 200 papers across all policy areas, looking at policies, spending streams, and saying, you know, what are we doing with this and how is it going? There's also a lot of collaborative work that our people are trying to kind of drive, particularly on policy questions that span government departments, like climate. You know, you have obviously Department of Communications, Climate Action, and Environment, but then you also have agriculture, which is one of the big sectors, you know, that contributes to the greenhouse gas emissions. Then you have transport and energy and so on. So we're trying to kind of build cross collaborative analytical work that will tackle those more complex cross-cutting issues. And then we obviously work very hard within government departments to then feed those messages into the discussions, and we do a lot of presentations to share the policy insights that we get through the analysis. And all with the view to actually help that when the decisions are being made around how we prioritise the funding, that evidence and data and analysis actually features in a big way in those discussions. that we need to have policies that are, first of all, designed with a lot of thinking around the rationale, so understanding why are we doing something. Then when we think about, okay, we want to do this, looking at options and how, what's the best way to do it, but then trying to do it in an efficient way. So that we are cognizant of the cost and unit costs and so on and how that's evolving. That we have a good handle of what the outputs are from our policies and service provision that we do with those policies. What are the outcomes for people who are actually accessing those services? What's the wider impact? Another very important one is sustainability, because sometimes things even very well designed and very effective and efficient just may not be sustainable in the long run, and it may have to be reframed. So these are the guiding principles, and just to kind of put that through a different lens, so those principles then, when you think about the actual policy life cycle and where the data and analysis and evaluation actually feeds in. First is the problem definition. This is basically, you know, when an idea is conceived, you know, so we say, we want to reduce poverty. Okay, so that's an important thing to do. And you can see that a lot of policies are kind of designed around those general ideas, you know. It's a good thing to do, reduce poverty. But the question really is, and where analysis, and particularly, you know, kind of evaluation, ex ante type of evaluation comes in, is to try to understand, you know, what exactly are you trying to do? So, when you say you want to reduce poverty, how are you going to measure poverty? Is it relative poverty or is it absolute poverty? What's the poverty rate at the moment? Is it relative or absolute that you're measuring? Is it everybody's poverty or is it maybe child's poverty? Or poverty in the elderly cohort? So you need to kind of really think it through, and this is where you need a lot of data and analysis, both qualitative and quantitative. First, understand what the problem is and what exactly are you trying to solve. And that kind of crystallizes what your target is. And once you actually do this well, then you're setting up the building stones of the ex post evaluation. Because if you know exactly what you want to do, who your target group is, then you're already setting up the concept of what kind of data would you need to be able to say that you've actually achieved what you set out to do. So then, when you decide that you want to reduce poverty, and you decide what cohort exactly and how you're going to measure poverty, then you say, well, how do we go about this? So we can do that in different ways. We can give people money, we can give them better access to services, we can do both. We can, particularly invest in one intervention. Say if it's child poverty, you might decide that you want to ramp up investment in education early childhood and have children more in kind of institutionalized kind of education training in the early years, because you might believe that that early intervention might help them. So there's different ways in which you can do that. And even if you decide on one, you could do that in different ways. If you say you want to give money to families who are at risk of poverty, do you give it to the household? Do you give it to the earner through tax breaks? Do you, just give subsidy? Do you give a medical card? Like what? There are different ways in which you can help them. And here again, you need data and analysis to try to evaluate these different options that you have. And here you're using things like looking at regulatory impact analysis if you want to include a regulation, you're looking at cost-benefit analysis, or multi-criteria analysis, and so on. Once you actually decide the option and you implement it, then you obviously need to do some data and analysis around, well, how is it going? So you want to see, well, you know, how many children or how many, you know, families have we reports to, and how much, and so on. You want to observe that over time to see how that's going. You want to look at outputs, you know, in terms of numbers of participants and past participants and so on. But really what's very important is that after a while, you need to kind of look back and do the ex post evaluation and say, did we actually reduce poverty at the start of the year that we set out to do? And here you're looking, ideally, you would want to do something like kind of actually back evaluation where you would have a group that you treated, that you did give this help, and then group the similar characteristics that you didn't, and then see whether the two groups fared differently because you intervened. Now, in public policy, that's often very, you know, difficult to do, even though scientifically it's more, it's the most accurate way of assessing whether something has made a difference. And it's difficult because you know, say if you want to reduce poverty, you can't say to this group, we're not going to give you anything because you're a control group. So you just be poor, and then we have this group that we're going to give money to or subsidies to or whatever, and you just wait there and see how this works. So you can't do that for ethical reasons and so on. So there are other techniques that you can use, and I'm sure you're learning about those, where you can kind of proxy and try to estimate whether there is a significant difference because of the intervention or there isn't. But this is a very important piece, and it's typically the weakest link in evaluation. And not just in Ireland, but in most developed countries. There's a big kind of, you know, there's dialogue going on, and the OECD, for instance, is very active in this space of trying to help countries share experience of how to institutionalize the use of evidence, and particularly ex post evaluation in policy. And then there's a challenge of then feeding that into, you know, okay, so we got the results of evaluation, we need to now reflect on our program and take the learnings from that to make it better. Or to stop it if it's not working and try something else. And that's again, you know, not very, very, it's not a very common sort of practice, because you could imagine how politically challenging it might be to say, oh, we can stop this scheme because we don't think it's not really as effective as we thought it would be, people are already accessing those services and so on. But we need to, I suppose, and this is what I just is trying to do, is by producing quality evidence, challenging and saying, you know, we have to embrace this kind of way of working where we do reflect on things and try to make it better rather than shy away from the results and just continue on business as usual. So the building blocks of our work, data is the fundamental block of the work that IGC does. And here we are talking about all types of data, but in particular where a lot of emphasis now is an effort. We're working together with the Central Statistics Office trying to leverage the administrative data to help us understand how businesses are performing. And administrative data is data that's collected to provision of public services, you know, as a matter of course, typically for transaction purposes. So if you're enrolled in school, you're enrolled here, there's a record here about, you know, you being a student here, so that's administrative data. But imagine and what the CSO is trying to do is to link a lot of those administrative data sets to enable us to actually do a lot of this analysis. And, you know, for instance, you have traveled a certain path from your early education into your primary, secondary, and now your tertiary education. So, you know, from a policy point of view, it's very important to be able to see, well, what happens to people who travel through those paths, you know, and whether our investment in education and training is actually yielding what we wanted to in terms of public policy around education and training. So the data is a very important piece, and there's a lot of progress being made around that. But data alone, you know, having a lot of because there are a lot of databases around government departments and their agencies, the provision of services that are kept. But But unless you actually, you know, put that data into context, it can't help us understand how we're actually doing in provision of services. So this is where IGs comes in, and then, you know, as policy analysts, people typically have some more sophisticated tools that they can get further insights from the data, so they can use things like econometrics and other kind of quantitative methods to get further insights from the data. And then it's not just about, you know, our beautiful charts and tables that we can use for analyzing that data, it's about feeding that into policy information within us and making it better. Just to give you examples of kind of what this actually means and what are we working on. So I'll give you a few policy areas and just kind of show you the questions that we're grappling with and where this analysis kind of feeds in and the challenges that we face. So for instance, Brexit is a big one now. Obviously there's a lot of talk about that. We know it's going to have a negative impact on the Irish economy. And there's a lot of noise about we need more money to make our country more resilient towards Brexit. And what our analysts are trying to really kind of drill into in order to kind of support that debate in a meaningful way are trying to see, well, what are we currently doing to support, say, enterprises? Who is going to be hit? So there's a lot of modeling work done to understand what sectors and what occupations are going to be affected in Brexit. Some different scenarios of Brexit. But then it's also trying to see, well, you know, we already spend $1 billion a year paid to tax or to grants on supporting enterprises. And when you look at policy, there's definitions say around what